Life is rough, man. It ain't easy to do this thing. I know what Paul felt like when he said, man, I don't want to preach to others and I myself get disqualified. I want to run the whole race that's set before me. You gotta press.
Lord, put a song in my heart too. Be the rhythm that I march to, towards you. Keep me warm like the Sherlin with grace as I walk with the wind of this world in my face. This place is not home and I can sense it as I roam the earth. I've learned how to pitch my tent quick, then break it down, taking it down a notch. May I be found to be faithful, safely counted in your flock. Earth is not a safe place to wander. Many of the faith-based lay waylaid and conquered, mainly cause they traded your honor for created things, being fond of these things, kind of trying to have two gods ruling. But you're not fooled and you're not cool with pseudo-gods dueling. They're trying to bump you for your space. They get in front of you, then have us front on you to your face. I pray for all the soldiers who've fallen from so strong in their walk to no longer even crawling. And I'm not looking down from so high, cause I know that there but by the grace of God would go I. And probably have, I'd probably crash if it wasn't for your grace covering all my mistakes and other flaws. Lord, teach me to learn to love your law, like the writer of the Psalm 119 and other songs. City for 50 right
ambitious men? Maybe 40. No, 30. 10. Could you find 10 men in our nation who resist the enticements of Satan or the fighting temptations with spiritual fruit like in Galatians, who respond when hearing the truth, whether they like what they're tasting or not? The race is not given to the swift. One must endure to be sure that God has given them a gift. If not, his floor is a constant continental drift. His conscience is his only compass, competent only in shifts. The twist is that I'm confident of this. God warns us and admonishes, and yet his promise is legit. And this is not as astonishing as it gets. We're autonomous, yet his honor is sovereign in his intent. What I meant is that his providence is sensed, even if we're abominous and pay homage with just our lips.
We must press on, press on, yes, on, press on.
We must press on, press on, yes, on, press on.
Over and over, the scriptures warn us that we must run the race that is set before us. But God informs us, who could be against us if he's for us? The text ensures us that God's grace supports us to stop taking shortcuts. Who can thwart the plan of the Lord? Not death or life can separate those that his hands secure. If it sounds like I'm talking out both sides of my neck, I'm not. I'm talking out both sides of the text. So watch and listen to the words you hear. You must muster the strength just to persevere. And even though we compete, what God begins, he completes. Faith is the arena, eternal life is the reward. A great cloud of witnesses stands to applaud all those who win the wreath and celebrate God's grace for those who continue in belief. So yes, we can rest, cause we're blessed.
Yeah, just
as long as we
press on, press on, yes, on, press on.
We must
press on, press on, yes, on, press on.
We must
press on, press on.
This one gonna hit him right here.
So many people are hurt inside. Don't even know him, even though they might have heard of God.
Get into this.
Can he love me? Will he hear my prayer?
Oh, I think I'm ugly when he sees my clothes and sees my hair.
I heard of a savior, heard he bled and died.
Yes, he
can
did.
Give him my sins and we can get his life. Yet I wonder for me if he will even care.
Let me get up in this verse right now. I'm thinking back to when we first got down. I only groped, but when you searched, I found. Snatch quick, though you knew how I acted. That's what's sick. I was a pick that you drafted. A backflip, but a split couldn't be more backwards. In fact, that's classic. I love to see your tactics, but I think back to when I shrink back from the real beat. It's real deep. I really thought you could never feel me, cause my shirts were double X. When really I was a small double shirts for the effect. When really it wasn't called for. Pants baggy, they sagged and dragged on the floor.
But I was never that poor to show the back of his drawers. But I did hang, kick slang, me and my boys did. Rock durag till it put a crease in our foreheads.
And on the surface of the set we were worthless. But I'm glad you purposed the love us and you made us your purchase.
So many people are hurt inside. Don't even know him, even though they might have heard of God. Can he love me? Will he hear my prayer?
Don't think I'm ugly when he sees my clothes and sees my hair.
I heard of a savior, heard he bled and died. We can give him our sins and we can get his life. Yet I wonder for me if he will even care.
When he sees my clothes, oh, when he sees my hair.
I was convinced of your power, so I was down to comply with your standard. Your God the Father, Creator, I was your product. But I noticed my focus, it wasn't on you. My hope was you would meet me in heaven. But as for earth, I roll with the hood. I really didn't want your heaven, just didn't want hell more. I really didn't want your presence, just didn't want hell more. I didn't know you were beautiful. You made advances, but in fact, I pushed you back like a cuticle.
I
was a bad date, but now I know what it was. You got lumped in with some people like a crab cake. They elevate their own.
They celebrate.
They make their own what's right. They say it's what you like. Everything else, they make it wrong. I'm glad you don't hate our musical fashion, unless these things and how you intend us to use them are clashing. Cause for us, this is just a part of the culture, but it's the reason why some think they shouldn't try to approach you.
Oh, man sees the outside, but God sees the inside. No matter your outside,
no matter.
Through faith he'll come inside. Man sees
even though they might have heard of God. Can he love me? Will he hear my prayer?
Won't think I'm ugly when he sees my clothes and sees my hair.
I heard of a savior, heard he bled and died. We can give him our sins and we can get his life. Yet I wonder for me if he will even care.
When he sees my clothes, or when he sees my hair.
I can weep, so many people never heard of the name. Yeah, they heard the word Jesus, but never heard of his fame. They feel cut off from him, not just cause of their sin, but because of their clothes, hair, or their color of skin. And they've been afloat, drowning in sin. We're in a boat, yet they've never been approached, cause we see him as different folks. God's all for universal. He wants you in a circle, he wants you in a do-rag, and he wants you in the purple hair. Now you can just take a cursory glance at the word and see God made the plans of diversity. Is there one godly ethnic group in the church? Should we all wear one polyester suit? Or maybe rock sandals and robes? No ham, I suppose. When we meet, maybe we should only eat salmon and loaves. Should we only like the organ or the violin? I'm inquiring, I admire men up in the choir band, women. But one minute, why do some people assume that God's iPod got no tunes, they got the boom back? He's with white, with black, with black, with Asian, with rock, country jazz, with rap. So
many people are hurt inside. Don't even know him, even though they might have heard of God. Can he love me? Will he hear my prayer?
Won't think I'm ugly when he sees my clothes and sees my hair.
I heard of a savior, heard he bled and died. We can give him our sins and we can get his life. Yet I wonder for me if he will even care.
Clothes, or when he sees my hair.
That's what I'm saying right there, man. Gotta look on the inside. God chooses the unlikely. It's feeling good. A lot of hurt in this world. Lord, do your thing. You gotta do some healing.
Y'all got it. So let's celebrate. Come on, Calvin, let's do this.
Now I need everybody, everybody, to clap your hands. Sing along with me.
Father, Father, Father,
let the people say,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Let the nation say,
Holy Spirit, yes.
Yes.
We adore you.
Whole world say,
yes.
Bottom of it. Even if you hopped in the cockpit of a rocket and shot up, you still couldn't rise above it. In the Trinity is where it originates. Redemptive history is where God demonstrates. In the cross and at Pentecost and beyond, when he calls and renovates, all he regenerates. We're the mud kid, he's the potter. On top of that, we're a love gift from the Father to the Son. And now that his love has been poured into our hearts through the Spirit, we can call him Abba. And to understand sonship is integral. And it's particular, none of this is general. What can we say about the love of the Son? It's abundant and plentiful. He's wonderful. Let him know.
He made Christ the visible image of the Ancient of Days. His immutable loves remaining the same, which he proved by his blood he graciously gave.
His love is the deepest,
resurrected to represent us.
The Son intercedeth.
Though his work is done, yet he bleeds his blood in his cleanness as the judge's appeasement.
His blood has redeemed us.
We're his possession
from the clutches of demons.
He gives protection. Daily my status is his perfection. Justified today because of his intercession.
He pursued us first and removed the curse.
For who?
The church.
Satan wants to ruin her. But how can we be snatched from the hand of him who rules the earth and the universe?
Hey.
Yeah.
Jesus, love for the weak sheep. Got drug for my messes, covered in freshness. Yeses, love is the bestest. It's a haven he's brought us to rest in. Christ's ocean, the covenant blessings. There's no way to compare the weight of his care. By grace, God made us his heirs. Christ's love isn't shallow, but rather the best we can show is at best just a shadow. To the loftiest, costliest love, God on the cross spilling lots of his blood. His love in the greatest of measures has brought us the greatest of treasures. But what could be better than staying forever with Christ to the praise of his splendor?
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. It's a heaven of heaven to
Sukasa, I ain't never met a stranger. The gospel's what I bring ya, and I drop that like an anchor. It's relevant whether you're black or blanca, like Bibles or bangers, drink Starbucks or Sanka. All thanks to he who's all in the midst. His church, he's building it. What you see are witnesses. Yeah, got differences, color, shapes, and sizes. But what unifies us is we're sinners and we realize this. All fail, all frail, born dead as a doornail. Yeah, it took a miracle, God breathed, and when he breathed, all hell broke loose, chains fell. Even for good dudes, we believe the good news. Started loving Jesus even more than good food. More than them jewels, more than a good cruise. More than good sex, more than good music. We the church.
Always say take in the church, but they don't ever take.
Well, welcome, 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 everybody.
Here we go.
To a beautiful summer Sunday morning where we are here to praise, to worship, to honor the Lord our God. God bless you, DPCC. Welcome, welcome, welcome to another DPCC worship in the morning, Sunday morning. We're going to go ahead and get right into it. We're going to begin with prayer. We want you to please keep your brothers and sisters in mind during the week. Continue to pray for one another during the week and let God know that you're thinking of your brothers and your sisters. And just petition God that they would be well, that they would get better, that they would come off of the prayer list with his healing, with his blessing. There are many people on the list, as you see. Please keep them in your prayers. I want to add Danita Thompson, who recently suffered I believe multiple strokes. But thank God she is back home now. And so just please keep people in your prayers. Keep your brothers and sisters in your prayers, okay? So let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for another opportunity to come before you to worship in spirit and in truth with our brothers and sisters. We thank you, Lord, that you count us as your children. We don't want to take that lightly. We don't want to take it for granted. And so, Father, help us to always avail ourselves of this great privilege you've given us to humble ourselves and come before your throne of grace in prayer, especially in times of need. And so, Father, of course, you know that this is a time of need for us, as every time is really a time of need while we're here in this Christ-rejecting world. And so, Father, we ask that you would please have mercy on those who are rejecting Christ, who are rejecting the pull of your Spirit on them, O God. And Father, we ask, O God, that you would open up the eyes of those who are blind, those who are still groping in darkness, those who Paul says are perishing. And so, Father, we ask that you would open up the eyes of our family members, the eyes of our co-workers, the eyes of our schoolmates, the eyes of our children, the eyes of whoever we come into contact with, oh God, by your Spirit and by the power of your gospel. Father, we thank you for each other. We thank you so much for this gathering. We ask, oh God, that those who are watching online would truly worship you in spirit and truth. We ask that you would be wherever they are. Let them feel your presence wherever they are, as we are all in the same body of Christ. And so, Father, we pray for all of our leaders across the country, and not just the leaders of this country, but the leaders all over the world, oh God, that they would do things that make for peace for those over whom they have charge. And so, Father, we thank you, we bless your holy name, and we give all this time to you and to you alone. Help us to concentrate on you, to worship you in spirit and in truth. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray, and we thank you. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. We're going to go ahead and sing a little hymn. I don't know if y'all notice hymn, but it's called Behold What Love. Behold What Love. And I haven't sang this hymn in a while. I think I was probably, I might have been in my teens the last time I sang this hymn, but it's a really good hymn. The words are really, really good. Behold what love. All right? So let's sing it together. I guess I should give y'all the melody for this verse, right? Okay. It goes like this. Behold what love, what boundless love the Father hath bestowed on sinners lost, that we should be now called the sons of God. See how it works? Behold, what manner of love, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Okay, so I might have started a little too high, but that's sort of how it goes, okay? All right. So let's back up to verse 1 again. All right. Behold what love, what boundless love the Father hath bestowed on sinners lost, that we should be now called the sons of God. Behold what manner of love, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. No longer far from him, but now by precious blood made nigh, accepted in the well-beloved, near to God's heart we lie. Chorus. Behold what manner of love, What manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Next verse. What we in glory soon shall be, it doth not yet appear. But when our precious Lord we see, we shall his image bear. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. With such a blessed hope in view, we would more holy be, more like our risen glorious Lord, whose face we soon shall see. Chorus. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Okay, hallelujah, hallelujah. I know that was a little tough, but that was a great song. Now we're going to have another video selection, not as rough as that one, and we're going to just let that one play, okay? This is a new song, too, so we're not going to know the words to this song yet, all right? Okay, let's hear this song.
Good plans for me. If and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. Fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. So fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. He has good plans. He has good plans. Take heart in deserts and gardens. Oh, he has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father has good plans. Thank you, Lord, for the plans for my life.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. God bless you. We are going to talk today about sons, children, and heirs. Sons, children, and heirs. Reminds me of, what is that, The Wizard of Oz? Where it says lions, tigers, and bears, oh my. I was thinking about that when I was looking at this, sons, children, and heirs. Oh, my. That's how I feel when I look at this passage. We're only going to look at about six verses today in the epistle that Paul wrote to the church at Rome. If you all recall, just by way of introduction, 2 weeks ago, actually, when we spoke, we were talking about the life-giving spirit from Romans chapter 8. And we want to go back to that chapter and go a little bit further than when we left off last time. And you recall, you'll see in a second that these few verses are connected to those prior verses in a very straightforward way. And you got to remember a few things about that when you look at these verses. And so let's read. We're going to read the first verse 12, and then I want to jog your memory about the last message from Romans chapter 8. And so what we're going to see in this first verse is that believers live as those set free from the law of sin and death. Y'all remember that we talked about the law of sin and death, in which all of us, before we came to Christ, were under. We were held in that law. There are two spheres that Paul talks about. He talks about the sphere of the law of sin and death, and he talks about the law of the spirit of life, okay, the law of the life in the spirit in Jesus Christ. And so we, of course, have been moved, we've been changed from what we used to be, where we walked in the flesh, and now we are now in the spirit. And because we're in the spirit, certain things apply to us that applied to us before differently now. In other words, that law had us down, had us crushed, had us under the ultimate penalty for disobedience to God. And yet we found out last time that because we're now in Christ, because of what the Spirit has done for us, God sending His Spirit to us and in us to indwell us, because we have placed faith in Christ, now we have no longer any what? Condemnation. Remember that from last time? Yeah. There is therefore now no condemnation. There's no death sentence. And so instead of operating the way we used to, now we operate in the realm of the Spirit, okay? Because He's given us new life to live, all right? And so as we read verse 12, look at what it says. It says, so then, based on what he talked about in those first 11 verses, he says, so then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. Okay, y'all remember last time we talked about the flesh, the sarx in Greek, the Greek word is sarx. And so that word means that in our flesh, in our fleshly bodies, there is no good thing. I know many people are going to tell you that you know, people do good over here and those people do good over there. The problem with that is because they're doing it without the right outlook, even the so-called good things that a wicked person does, even the so-called good things, even the millions of dollars that the wicked give to charity are an abomination to God. They're not good. In fact, somebody called Jesus good one day, and he said, why do you call me good? There is no one good. Nobody's good. And so don't be fooled by this world's thinking into thinking that people are good. People are not inherently good. That's a misconception that Satan has propagated in the world so that people will tolerate anything except for Jesus. Have you noticed that people will tolerate pretty much, people will tolerate Muslims, people will tolerate Buddhists, people will tolerate Jehovah's Witnesses. They will tolerate almost anything except for you talking about Jesus. That's because, as we saw last time, everyone is born with this natural bent away from God. And they will accept that which is not true so that they can suppress the truth. But Paul says, you know what? You've now been moved from the realm of the flesh to the realm of the Spirit. And so therefore, you don't have to follow those dictates. You don't have to be like that. You don't have to keep walking in the flesh. And again, the flesh is that part of us, and really all of us, living in the body, doing that which is not pleasing to God. It's the Paul says earlier when he was introducing this concept, he says, in my flesh I know there's no good thing. He says, when I would do good, evil is there present with me. And the good that I want to do, sometimes I can't find it. Why can't I find it? It's because in my flesh there is no good thing. And so we have to be translated. We have to be moved. We have to be taken out of the realm of the flesh that had control of us since our birth by virtue of our being descendants of Adam and Eve, who fell into sin back in Genesis chapter 3. And we have to be moved to a new realm where it's not the flesh that's in control, but it's the Spirit that's in control. It's the Spirit that's given you a different outlook on the world. You don't, in other words, we've been given new glasses. We've been given new glasses. That's what Paul is kind of alluding to. We don't look at things the way we used to. The older generation used to say, I look at my hands and my hands look new. They say, I look at my feet and my feet do too. They say, I don't talk the way I used to do. I don't go the same places I used to go. That was good theology. That was straight from the Bible theology. That was telling us that the stuff that we used to look at and the way we looked at the world has been radically changed by the indwelling of the Spirit of God. I don't even look at my neighbor the same way I used to. I don't look at my coworker the same way I used to. I don't look at my boss the same way I used to. I look with a different outlook because, you know what? I have the Spirit of God dwelling in me, and He has infused me with new life in Christ. And so because we're in Christ, notice I'm saying we don't have to be like we used to be. We can be the way we used to be, but we don't have to be. Those who don't know Christ, those who are not under the control and influence of the Spirit, they have no choice. They are automatically under the influence of Satan and can't do a thing about it. The Bible says they're taken captive by him at his will. They're powerless to defend themselves against the influence of Satan. But not so with you. We don't have to, as Paul says here, we don't owe any debt to the flesh anymore, because what happened? Christ paid our debt.
Amen.
And so now that the debt that we owe, which is death, by the way, our debt was death. Our debt to God for our sinfulness was death. But Christ has delivered us from that death. Amen. And that's why Paul said at the end of chapter 7, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Then he said, I thank God through Jesus Christ. That's how we got delivered. Amen. And so now we don't owe our old fleshly life any debt. We don't owe the law of sin and death any debt. We can live differently now. And so he brings up another point, which I alluded to a second ago. Paul tells us that believers conquer sin by the Spirit. A lot of people don't quite get this. A lot of Christians don't quite get this. Okay, I want you to read this verse. Look at verse 13. It says, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Okay, in other words, if you keep doing the things that normal people do, right, with the same outlook as everybody else, as the same outlook you had before you were converted, if you keep doing those kinds of things, you're going to die. And don't get it twisted. All of us are going to die. Okay? All right? And so what I think happens when people become Christians is they think that because they're in Christ, they can do their old types of things and they're now immune to the effects of sin. Paul says, no, not at all. If you keep doing those things, it's going to lead to the same thing that it was leading to before, to your death. So don't think that you can start taking drugs. Don't think that you can drink yourself to death and you're going to be okay because you're in Christ. That's not true. It's just not true. A lot of Christians think that way because they're not understanding that you don't have to do that. See, you got power now that allows you to say no. You remember that marketing campaign? Just say no? Well, if you're not in Christ, you can't just say no. How? Sin is a part of your very being. It's a part of your very fiber. And if you don't have something stronger than sin, how can you fight it? How can you get from under it if you don't have the tools, if you don't have the weapons to actually overcome it? That's why Paul says, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's how you overcome it. That's how you fight sin and win. But if you don't have the Spirit in you, you don't have anything in you to fight it. And so Paul says, look, this is what you got to do. If you keep living that same old way, according to the flesh, guess what? You're going to die. You're going to reap the same benefit. You're going to reap the same wages that he talked about in chapter 6, verse 23. The wages of sin is still death, even if you're a Christian. But the gift of God, of course, is eternal life. And that eternal life starts now once you get the indwelling Spirit. And he wants you to start living eternal life now. Don't wait till you get to heaven. Live it now. Start living. Y'all remember Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and may have it more abundantly. He wasn't saying I've come so that you could go to heaven. That's only part of eternal life. And you can't get to that part until you die here. So he says, you know what? I want you to live abundantly now. Well, how do you live abundantly? You live in a way that's consistent with who God is. You live in a way that's in obedience to him. You live in a way that's pleasing to the one who created you. And so he says, Paul says, but if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. That's how you live a pleasing an honorable life before God. You got to put, you'll see the highlighted words, put to death. We talked about this in our Bible study one time. We looked at Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, I believe it was. And we were talking about putting to death. In other words, put to death means to take the life of. It means to end the life of something. And then it kind of lists the things that you put to death. Put to death, or in King James, it might say mortify, okay? Put to death greed and covetousness and stuff like that. Put to death all those things that are earthly in you. That's what he talks about. That's what Paul says. He says everything about your old life that was displeasing to God, put that stuff to death. End its life. Don't let it continue to live in your mortal bodies. Don't let it fester. Don't let it continue to have a foothold in your life. And then, of course, as you put things to death in your old self, in your old man, you got to put something on. In other words, when you put off and put to death, you got to put on and bring to life. And what are you supposed to put on? You're supposed to put on the new man that's been created in Christ Jesus, and that's putting on that fruit of the Spirit. That's exhibiting those types of things. All the stuff that God likes for you to have and to do, that's what you put on. But the stuff that he freed you from, you got to put it off and kill it. And it, but look at what it says, though. It says, but if you, by the Spirit, you do this. Mm-hmm. It doesn't say you do it.
Right.
It says you need help to do this.
Right.
You can't do this on your own. That's why I said there's a difference between those who don't know Jesus and those who do. Those who know Jesus have the Spirit. We talked about that last time we were in Romans chapter 8, remember? Those who are who believed in Jesus have the Spirit of God indwelling them. And now they got all the power they need to fight and to put to death. To put to death maliciousness, to put to death gossip, to put to death madness, anger, clamor, to put to death all those ugly and bad traits that we were all born with, every one of us. To put to death murder. Well, you say, I ain't never murdered nobody. But Jesus says, if you hate your brother without a cause, you're a murderer. So what do I need? I need to put to death hate. I need to stop hating folk. Once I come into Christ, I got power to actually love people I used to hate. Ain't that something? That's how powerful the Spirit of God is. He is God, and so he is able to enable us to do things we could not do before. All kinds of putting to death. And so we as Christians, we have to realize that in order to live lives pleasing to God, we have to trust, we have to rely on the Spirit of God to help us put stuff to death. That's part of our former way of thinking. It's part of our former outlook. Okay? And by the way, how exactly? Because sometimes we get lost in the highfalutin language of Scripture sometimes, right? And it says, do this by the Spirit. What do you mean, do this by the Spirit? Well, what does the Spirit do? Y'all remember what Jesus said the Spirit was going to do? He was going to guide you into the truth. Remember that? John chapters 14 through 16. He was going to reprove the world of sin. He was going to show people their sin so they can understand that they violated God's law. He's going to empower you to do that which you could not do before. And so how does he do that, though? He does that by his very presence inside of you. And he does that, watch this, based on the word of Christ. That's how he does it. Jesus says, when the Spirit comes, he's going to take of mine and give it to you. How does he take of Christ and give it to you? Well, we've got this thing called a New Testament. It's part of the Bible. And it shows us Jesus's earthly life, shows us how he came and died on the cross, shows us how he came and did the will of the Father his entire life. We need to get to know the New Testament. Don't we? We need to get to know the book that the Holy Spirit inspired for our growth. All right? Everything we need to live and to grow in a godly life is in that book. It's in the Bible. And so what the Spirit's going to do is once you crack your Bible, I don't know if I should even ask this question. I'm going to just look at the camera when I say it. I'm not going to look at the people that's here. I'm looking at the camera. I don't want to see no faces when I ask this question. How many of us actually read our Bibles during the week? We ain't counting Sunday. Don't try to get over. Sunday is a part of the week. I know that, right? And when we come to church, we read the Bible a little bit, right? But I'm asking, I ain't looking at nobody. I got blinders on right now. I'm looking at the camera, straight at the camera. How many of us take time out of our week to actually open up the Bible? Well, if you do it electronically, that's fine. Open up the Bible, though, and read the Bible and study the Bible. Ingest the Bible. Ingest the words of Christ. How many of us are actually doing that? If I were to tell you some statistics that I've seen, you would be, to use the word, the King James words for verse 12, you'd be mortified. Okay? You'd be mortified that people who call themselves Christians don't actually read the Bible. And yet the Bible is our guide for all life and practice. Let me say that again. The Bible is our guide for all life and practice. So let me give you a couple examples. If you got a problem on your job, and you got, let's say you got a problem with your supervisor, they ain't treating you right or something. The Bible is our guide for life and practice on the job too. There's some things that the Bible talks about for how we're supposed to act when we're on the job. Okay? You see, most of us think that God has to change the job in order to change your situation. But what he really needs to do is to change us.
Right.
See, he says things like us. He says things to us in the Bible like this. He says, when you work, work as unto the Lord. Y'all remember that from Bible study in Colossians? All right. When you go to work, don't work like you're working for your boss that's there, but work like you're working as unto the Lord Jesus Christ. See, that's an outlook type of thing. See, in your flesh, you're like, oh, I don't like the way she talked to me. So, do you think Jesus liked the way everybody talked to him? Do you really think that Jesus could not have simply wiped somebody out with but a thought? If he wanted to, he told the mob that came after him when he got arrested, don't you know I could call, what was it, 12 legions of angels to defend me if I wanted to? In fact, when the mob came to arrest Jesus that very night, they came, mob of people came. The Bible says in one of the Gospels, it says as they approached and they were looking for Jesus, and Jesus said, I am he. All of them fell back on the ground. He could have kept them on the ground. He showed that he had power over his enemies. Make no mistake, he's got power over anybody who thinks they're your enemy as well. So, but what does he tell us to do? He didn't tell us pray that the boss get removed. I never see that in scripture. I never see that. But what I do see is work as unto the Lord. See, if you change your attitude to be that of the Spirit, to be under the control and leading of the Spirit, then the job situation will change because your outlook has been completely changed. And you won't take offense every time somebody says something to you at the job. Instead, you can turn that around, and when they see you don't take offense, you can turn that around and use it as an opportunity to show them how good your God is. To show them how gracious God is, to tolerate even insolence from somebody who's in authority. But you're going to need the Spirit to do that. Amen. And the Spirit likes to work through the Word of God. Okay? That's just one instance. I we'll talk about some more later maybe. But check this out. Remember, let me go to the next Roman numeral. because I really need to get to this. Paul makes a very straightforward statement, okay? He tells us that believers are the Spirit-led sons of God, okay? Let's look at this verse in verse 14. It says, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God," okay? Let's read it again. "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God," okay? Now, don't take exception because you see sons of God and not sons and daughters. The word and the way that they talked when Paul wrote this, and especially in this context, sons refers to anybody who is an offspring of a parent. Okay, it's not just saying the male children of God. It's saying all those who are offspring of God. Okay, all right. So all believers are sons of God. And what he does now, he begins to show us three different aspects of our sonship. Okay? Yep. Check this out. The first one, he says, is adoption. Okay? Believers are sons of God by adoption. That's the first one. Okay? Look at verse 15. It says, "For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear." All right? Talking about the fear that was involved under the law of sin and death. Okay, everybody was afraid because, and you can, you, matter of fact, I'll give you a real good test to see if people are afraid of their sinfulness. Okay, they are, they just don't usually articulate it. But ask somebody when you want to witness to somebody, just start a conversation with them so you can witness to them. Ask them what happens when you die. Just ask them that and see what they say. And then ask them, so, you know, if they answer kind of funny, do you think there's anything that's going to happen to you after you die? You could ask it that way, okay? And just see what they say, all right? And introduce to them the idea that there's a God waiting for them when they die. Just to start, look, you don't have to go for the jugular when you talk to somebody. Just ask them a couple questions here and there and see where they're at, okay? And when you ask them, well, something like, if you died today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Ask them something like that, okay? Then somebody might say, well, I don't really believe in hell. They may say, I don't believe in heaven. They may say, I don't believe in God. That's a launching pad for you to start talking to them and say, look, well, the scriptures kind of bear out that this is true and you should understand this. But even if you don't go that route, they're afraid even though they don't articulate it, okay? And they want to suppress the truth. They want to not believe in God. Why? Because you know what? If there's a God, I have much to fear. If there's a God when I die and I've lived a life that's not pleasing to him, there is much to fear. So don't think for a second that people aren't afraid. The Bible clearly tells us that people have been afraid of death ever since death came on the planet. Okay? Ever since. All right? All you got to do is tap into what's already there if you want to get them into a real spiritual conversation, okay, so that they can, you can draw out to them and get them to see their need for Jesus. People need Jesus whether they articulate it or not. But let me keep going. But watch what it says. "But you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father." Now, the first thing you notice is that you see the concept of sons. We receive the spirit of adoption as sons, okay? And again, sons is offspring from a parent, okay? BDAC says one whose identity is defined in terms of a relationship with a person or a thing. In other words, if you're a son or a daughter of God, your identity is defined by your relationship with that person at the end of son of or daughter of God. Okay, so now you're defined as a child or a son or a daughter of God. That defines all of us as believers. So no wonder when people see us acting a certain way, they say stuff like, I thought you were a Christian. Because your life is supposed to be defined by the relationship you have with God. And if you have no relationship with God, then I don't expect you to act like God. But if you got a relationship, if you say you got a relationship with God, I'm not saying we say it, but if you say that, then people are going to expect that you act like that.
Right.
Okay? And I think that's logical, right? That's the way it should be. If you say, I'm a child of God, I should act like a child of God. That's reasonable. Okay? If I say, I'm an atheist, you're probably going to act like an atheist. You're going to act like there is no God. Okay? All right. So look at the rest of the definition now. It says, in a special sense, the devout believers are sons of God. And then the last part of the definition says this. Watch what it says. It says, in light of the social context, it refers to people of special status and privilege. Okay. So back in the Roman critical world, when you were a son of somebody, okay, they basically said you have certain rights and privileges, special privileges. You got a special status because you're the son of so-and-so. If you were the son of the king or the son of Caesar or the son of some governor, you would be afforded mass respect, okay? Even if you ain't do nothing, right? You still be afforded certain respect, and they know you got certain privileges. You can walk up in, you know, if your father's the king, you can walk up in the palace and you good. If your father's the governor, you can walk into the tribunal or the judgment hall and they'll let you in because that's his son. If you're Caesar, your son can come to your palace and nobody's gonna keep you out. Similarly, if you are a son or daughter of God, there are certain rights and privileges that you have. Okay. Now, we're not going to talk about all of them today. I wish we had more time. We don't have time to talk about it. We'll save that for a different message. But the point is, you have been adopted. God has adopted us, y'all. Yeah. And so now, because we have become part of his family, we have certain rights and certain privileges. Okay? Again, you see the word adopted, right? Adoption, it means of those who believe in Christ, when it's talking about this context, are accepted by God as God's children with full rights. Notice the definition real quick. It says, of those who believe in Christ and are accepted by God. That's your new status. That's our new status. We were not accepted before. Ephesians chapter 2 tells us we were strangers from the covenant. We were without God in the world, but now we've been accepted. Yeah. I don't know about y'all, but being accepted has certain privileges. And if you just think about that, when you're accepted, you feel like you can get close to somebody if they accept you. Yeah. Well, God has now accepted us, so now we can come into close proximity to him. We can come near God now because we're accepted. I wish Christians would stop telling people that in order to be saved, you need to accept Jesus. I wish people would stop saying that. That's not in the Bible, by the way. It's not in the Bible. If you find a passage that says that, let me know. That's not what the Bible says. The closest thing to it is John chapter 1, verse 12, I believe it is. It says, but as many as have received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God. But it doesn't say, see, when you say accept, that's kind of acting like that person needs acceptance. See, you and I have been accepted because we needed acceptance. We couldn't get near him. We were sinners. And we were lost. And we were in darkness. We couldn't get near him if we tried. Because we didn't know how to get to him. We were strangers. And we had the stain of sin in us that kept us under the law of sin and death. Yeah. Every sinner has got to die. Every last one of them. Every last one of us got to die. But in Christ, God has now accepted us. And he's accepted us to the point where he don't just say, okay, you can be around me. But he's given us a new relationship called sonship, where not only do you get to be around me, but you get to come in my house. You get to come in my house. That's why we talk about the house of the Lord. A lot of people think the house of the Lord is the building you're worshiping in, but the house of the Lord is the reign and rule of God wherever it is. And his reign and rule is universal. So I don't have to be in a church in order to realize the rights and privileges that I have in Christ. I don't have to be in a church. I can be out on the street corner and still have the same power that I have in a church building. I still got the same, look, not my power, but I'm talking about the power of the Spirit who dwells in me. And that power will allow you to do stuff you couldn't do by yourself, remember? Let me try to finish this. Let me try to finish this. I like Lou Anita's adoption definition. It spells it out a little bit more. It says to formally legally declare that someone who is not your own child, not one's own child, is henceforth to be treated and cared for as one's own child, including complete rights of inheritance. Oh man. That's what God has done for us. Somebody who wasn't his own child. But by the way, do you realize that the Bible says that we who do not know the Lord, who do not know God through Jesus, we had a father before we met God. Y'all know who he was, right? The Bible says your father was Satan. That's what Jesus told his people in his day. He said, your daddy is Satan. That's what he told them. And the works of Satan, your father, you will do. That's why he says, that's why y'all trying to murder me. Because he was a murderer from the beginning. And y'all trying to do the same thing to me. In other words, every person born into the world is under the rulership in the house of, so to speak, of Satan. And the only way out is through Jesus Christ. That's the only way out. And so we thank God. We revel in the fact that we've been adopted into the family of God. Look at the last thing he said, though, in that verse, in verse 14. He said, not only have we been adopted, but he says, we cry, Abba, Father. Okay, y'all see that? I'm sorry, 15, at the end of verse 15, he says, we cry, Abba, Father. Now, guess what? Abba Father is only in the New Testament three times. Okay? Three times, all right? It's in, Galatians chapter 4, verse 6. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, into our hearts, crying, Abba Father. That's the second time. Okay? There's only one other time that Abba Father, that combination phrase, is in the New Testament. Okay? Guess where it is? It's in Mark 14:36. I want to read it because I want to show you something real quick. Watch this. And he said, now this is Jesus praying when he was about to go to the cross in the Garden of Gethsemane, okay? And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Y'all see that? So he's praying to his Father, God, and he says, he calls him Abba, Father. Abba is Aramaic for Father, okay? All things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Yet, not what I will, but what you will. I told you that when you become a son in a family, when you get a new daddy by adoption, you get all the rights and privileges of sonship. Okay? This son, the son of God, called his father, who we say is now our father, Abba Father. Y'all didn't see it. Y'all didn't get it yet. Y'all didn't get it yet. The same thing that Jesus calls him, we are allowed to call him. The same privilege we have to pray to God in heaven, we have the same privilege to pray to God in heaven. So when something happened in your life, and you know it done hit the fan and it's going down, like Jesus, it was going down right then. He was getting arrested that night. And he was going to be tried, he was going to be persecuted, he was going to be flogged, he was going to be crucified. When it goes down, fam, the first thing you did. Start praying, Abba, Father. Stop calling on God the Father. Look, start using the relationship you have through Jesus Christ. And don't you, look, don't get it twisted. The Father can decide to get you out or to keep you there. Yeah, just like he did with Jesus. Jesus said, not my will, though. I'd like to have this cup pass from me because I know the pain is going to happen and I know the separation I'm going to have to endure on the cross from you, but not my will. Just let your will be done. But I like that he shows us we got the same privilege, fam. We got the same privilege to call upon God anytime we get ready. Believers are children of God by the Spirit's witness. Look at this. Look at verse 16. I'm almost done. Just last two verses. It says the Spirit himself. I want you to take note of that too. The Spirit himself. Stop calling the Spirit an it. The Spirit is a he. Eternal masculinity. Okay? I know the Greek word for himself is neuter, but he is talked about in such a way that he's doing stuff. He's not just the wind of God, as Jehovah's Witnesses might try to teach you. He's a real person, and he indwells the believer, he himself. Watch this. The Spirit himself bears witness. The wind can't bear witness. The wind can blow. The wind can knock a tree down, but it can't bear witness. Bear witness is a cognitive function. Bear witness means I know something and I'm going to testify to the truthfulness of that thing. That's what bear witness is about. It's like if you're in court and you're going to be a witness to some fact or some event that happened, you're going to say, yeah, I was there. I saw this. I saw that. That's what happened. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. I like what the New English Translation says about this verse. Look at what it says. It says, in sum, Romans 8:16 seems to be secure as a text in which the believer's assurance of salvation is based on the inner witness of the Spirit. The implications of this for one's soteriology are profound. Soteriology just means your theology about salvation, okay? The objective data, as helpful as they are, cannot by themselves provide assurance of salvation. The believer also needs and receives an existential, ongoing encounter with God's Spirit in order to gain that familial comfort. That's a mouthful, but let me just tell you what it really means. Let me just boil it down real quick to what he's saying. He's saying that the Spirit of God in you actually testifies to you and gives you the assurance that you belong to God. That's what he's saying. He's saying, look, I know you got the Bible. I know you got the prophets and the apostles and you got their writings. He says, I know you got your fancy new, you know, your fancy church. And I know you got your pastor. And I know you got all this stuff available to you, gifts from God. But the thing you really need and that you actually have if you're a believer in Jesus, you have the indwelling Spirit himself telling you and confirming to you that you belong to Jesus. Wow. That you belong to God. Wow. That nobody can pluck you out of his hand. That you ain't going nowhere. That no matter what happens, come hell or high water, you are so safe that nothing can shake you from the palm of his hand. You, look, I don't care. Look, any non-believer, atheist, agnostic, whatever, come and tell you, hey, you don't know God exists. You ain't never seen God. You say, yeah, I ain't never seen him, but I feel him. He's inside of me. And you may not be able to feel him, and you don't know him, but I know him because he testifies inside of me. He's telling me every day, yeah, son, come on, do this. Daughter, come on, get up, try it again. Son, pray to the Father. He'll give you the strength to get through this thing. He's always witnessing. He's always taking of mine, like he said, like Jesus said, and giving it to you. He's always doing that. It's not a one-time thing that happened when you got saved and now he don't say nothing no more. He's constantly witnessing to the fact that you belong to God, that God is your Father. And nobody can take that away from you. I don't care who. You might not be able to explain all the scriptures as well as the next person. That's okay. But you know what you can't explain? I feel it moving. That's what the old Christians will say sometimes. I feel it moving. Moving on the inside. You remember people say stuff? We don't say like stuff like that. That's too old for us now. But I feel him moving. And I don't need you to tell me how I feel.
That's right. Right.
Just like they like to tell you. That's your truth. I got my truth. I got a truth. And my truth is the very Spirit of God telling me every day, son, you keep going. Son, it don't matter what it look like. Daughter, you can do this. I've given you power. I've given you strength. I got you covered.
Yeah.
All you got to do is just keep walking in the Spirit. You got that internal witness.
Yeah.
And he ain't. Look, and Jesus says he going to be with you how long?
Always.
Oh, he said till you get depressed. Is that what Jesus said?
Oh,
he going to be with you till you lose your job? That's when he going to leave?
Nope.
Oh, no, that's not what Jesus said. Jesus says he going to be with you forever.
Yes.
Forever. Forever. I'll never lose this witness. It don't matter what happened. I can never lose this witness. He's always there. Blessed assurance. That's why we sing that song. We got blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. The foretaste is the Spirit. That's why Ephesians chapter 1, verses 12 and 13, 13 and 14 tell us that when you believe the gospel of your salvation, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise.
Yes.
Until we get that final inheritance. He is the guarantee. He's the down payment on all of what God going to give you through Christ in the future. Last verse, verse 17, it says, and if children... So we see that we are sons and daughters by adoption, right? And we see now that if we are children of God, he says, and if children, then you're also heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. It's a mouthful in that verse. It's a mouthful. But I like what he says. I'm adopted. I'm a son. I'm an adopted son. And since I'm a son, and he doesn't just use singulars, he uses plural sons, and he uses children, all right, plural children. He says, not only are you a son, a daughter, and all of you are children who believe in Jesus, but he says, you're also heirs. What's an heir? Now, generally, we're used to hearing the word heir in connection with somebody dying.
Right.
But the word does not have to connotate the necessity of a death. Okay? Heir simply means you are given a possession or a gift. Okay? You have been given something, whatever it is. You are the beneficiary of someone else's graciousness. You're the beneficiary of someone else's wanting to give you something, okay? And so Paul says, because we are related to God by faith in Jesus, we become his children. That also makes us heirs. That is, we get something from God. We get gifts, okay? We get gifts. It means one who receives something as a possession, a beneficiary, right? Well, not only are we heirs of God, that is, he intends to give us some type of inheritance, but that also makes us fellow heirs with Christ. The only, generally speaking, the only way to be a fellow heir is you got to be in the same family.
Right.
Y'all sticking with me? So he's saying a lot in just this quick clause. He says, first of all, because you have become a child of God, a son of God, a daughter of God, you're actually a brother or sister of Jesus. And you also get a possession like Jesus does from God. Now, if you unpack that a little bit, from Hebrews chapter 1, we went over this in Bible study a couple weeks ago, chapter 1, verse 2. It says that the Son who God sent after he spoken to the prophets in multiplicity of ways. He says he has now sent his son, by whom he created the world and who he has what? Appointed heir of all things. Y'all didn't get it. Y'all didn't get it. Jesus is heir of all things. And that means everything belongs to him. So when we talk about the possession or the inheritance, Jesus inherits everything. And then Paul says, you know what? We get to piggyback. We get to join in on the firstborn's son, the firstborn son's inheritance. Since he got everything, he can distribute anything to us. Anything he wants. Okay? Now, there's a dual place where he does that. Most of the time, Paul is talking about eschatologically, right? Right? When you die and Jesus comes back, starts his kingdom, right? Revelation chapter 19. His kingdom starts. You start looking like you're glorified and all that, okay? And you got part of the kingdom. You start getting rewards and stuff like that. But I think it actually starts now. That's why you can pray and ask God for stuff. And Jesus says, if you believe and you ask according to my will, he says, God will give it. But he also says, I will do it. Yeah, ain't sticking with me, are you? Jesus says, I will do it if you ask according to the will of God in my name. So you don't have to wait till the eschatological future happens. You don't have to wait. You don't have to wait for every, look, I'm not saying you can get everything now. You can't, because you wouldn't be able to hold it anyway. But there's some stuff you can ask God for now, and he will give it. And Jesus will do it. Wow. If you just ask. Because look, he's heir to all things. Mm-hmm. And if he want to break you off a piece of his inheritance right now, he can do it right now. Amen. He owns it all. It's not waiting to be owned by Christ. It's already owned by him. Yes, indeed. All things belong to him. All things were created for him. All things were created through him and by him. So anytime he wants to utilize it for his glory, he can do so through you. But there's another with him in the text. There's two more, actually. We're heirs with him, but it also says, provided we suffer with him. And that's the part that many Christians don't want to do. Many Christians don't want to suffer with him. Yeah. We don't want to speak up and incur that, you know, that ridicule that he endured. We don't want nobody to reject us, even though we're accepted by the Most High King, by God himself. But make no mistake, if you're a Christian, you're going to suffer with Jesus. It's inescapable. Paul says in 1 Timothy, he says, all who try to live a godly life will suffer persecution. So if you're honestly trying to live for Christ, guess what? You're going to endure some type of persecution. It's inescapable. But guess what? There's another with him in the verse.
Yes, indeed.
There's heirs with him. There's suffer with him. But the third one is, you're going to be glorified with him. Amen. And just as he was raised from the dead, mm-hmm, and given new life, mm-hmm, in a new glorified body, never to die again, powerful body. Powerful body that could show up in a room that's got locked doors. We're going to be glorified with him. Amen. So when we talk about Romans chapter 8 for my next message, I think we're going to get to that part. We're going to get to that part that we've been waiting for the sons of God to be revealed. We'll talk about that next time, okay? But let's glorify God for the fact that we are sons, we are children, and we are heirs of God in Christ Jesus our Lord because of his indwelling spirit. All right. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless the Lord for the marvelous salvation he has bestowed upon us. That's why we had that song. I know it was a little rough, but Behold, we are children of God. We are children of God. You realize what that means? We have access. We're in the family. We're not just somebody that he knows about, but he loves us. And you know what? If you don't have a relationship with God today, you can start one right now. It's not even hard. Matter of fact, he's done all the work. All he wants you to do is to believe in his son, Jesus. What do you have to believe about Jesus in order to be saved? Well, the Bible tells us that you need to believe that he died for your sins, that he was buried in a real tomb. He actually died and was buried. It wasn't a trick. But that on the third day, God raised him from the dead. His father was pleased with his sacrifice. He accepted that sacrifice on your behalf. He said, you know what? My son did what I wanted him to do to save you. And if you would simply trust him for it today, he will save you. He will give you the forgiveness of sins. He will indwell you with his own spirit, which we've been talking about today. And he will give you, right now, he will give you eternal life. Right now. If that's you, trust Jesus today. We'd love to talk to you about it. We'd love to answer any questions that you may have about the faith. So get a hold of us on our website. Or at our, at this email address that's on the screen, connect@disciplespathcc.org. Just send us a note. Let us know what's on your heart, what's on your mind. If you're inclined to believe and to trust in this Jesus, we'd love to confirm that with you today. We'd love to take you through the scriptures to show you. You know what? We're not telling you what we want to say. This is just our truth. This is the truth of the Word of God. It's in the Bible. We didn't make the Bible. But holy men of God were moved by the Holy Spirit to write what's written in the Scriptures. And if you would believe God today, he'll save you right now. He'll save you right now. That's what we want to see. We want to see you saved. We want to see you indwelled with the Spirit. We want to see you living a life that's pleasing to God. And the only way to do so is by faith in Jesus. So hit us in the email. Check out our website. We'd love to get you in a Bible study. We're on break for August, but we'll be resuming sometime in September. We'll let you know on the channel as well. If you haven't already, please subscribe to the YouTube channel. Let us know that you're here. God bless you. If you want to partner with this ministry, you can give in several ways. We had a little issue when we switched over our systems, but ACH is back again. So if you want to give with your bank account, okay, you can do that. It's actually cheaper than using a debit or credit card, okay? So if you just put your bank account information in and you want to make a donation or make a recurring contribution, please do so. It's you may have to reset your password if you had a login already. If not, you can just sign up, but it's ready. And it's waiting for you to be used. We certainly appreciate your partnership in the gospel with us here at DPCC. God bless you. And you all have a wonderful rest of the Sunday and a wonderful rest of the week. Don't forget, pray for your brothers and sisters, okay? God bless you. Love you all. Have a great week.
Let it ride a little bit. I read about a man, Josephus documented, even at 12 years old, he was about his business, he was a living soul, he spoke the truth relentless, he asked profound questions, grown men like, yo, who is this? He was not a Christian, he was born a Jew, this youngin lived Torah, faithful through and through, followed his father's orders. He was gracious too, full of mercy, lived the law, but never let tradition rule. Rich dad, poor dad, he loved them both. See it, John Coltrane said it best, a love supreme. When we read, he had compassion.
passion, action. He will bring the world on a seesaw, but he's on his love thing. Haters wanna mute him. He was famous now. He healed thousands, but now he's on a green mile. He was executed. You want Yelly Yawn. The good news, he wrong. And for this, he hung. He lived a perfect life, died a criminal's death. Cause he was more than just a man. He was God in the flesh. So if you ever said, did or thought a bad thing, it only proves God is right. I saw conditioning. Told of depravity. Pride leads to hate. When pride is on our dinner plate, up goes the murder rate. Is bound to increase. We now looking for peace. We give our dirty rags. We brag and call it charity. A Christian nation in your imagination. We preaching overseas, neglecting basic needs. Let's turn to living holy, holy matrimony, to the one and only risen King of glory. And by risen I mean he got up from the grave. He was fully dead, now he's fully raised. He paved the way out the fires of hell. John 3:18, we condemned already. Can't you tell? Look how we treat each other. I don't taste almond joy. We tolerate each other. Box and Connor and Floyd. We exploit each other just to buy another toy. We call ourselves gods and render people void. But I'ma cling to Jesus in his holy cocoon. And with his metamorphosis, I come to full bloom. Spiritual transformation out from regeneration. And since my salvation, it's been sanctification.